Every great person in history knew this. Whether it was Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, the Wright brothers, Joan of Arc, they all had a vision. Couldn't see it, couldn't smell it, couldn't taste it, couldn't feel it, but it was alive in their mind. It was so alive in their mind that they began to live as if that future reality was happening in the present moment. So here's my question. Can you believe in a future that you can't see or experience with your senses yet, but you've thought about enough times in your mind that your brain is literally changed to look like the event has already occurred? The latest research in neuroscience says you can change your brain from living in the past to living in the future. And can you fall in love with that vision to such a degree that you come out of your resting state and change guilt or suffering into inspiration and joy and gratitude? To such a degree that your body as the unconscious mind does not know the difference between that external event and what you're creating internally, so that your body believes it's living in that future in the present moment, and you begin to signal new genes in new ways to change your body to look like the event has already occurred. The latest research in epigenetics says you can change your body by thought alone. Now reason this with me. If there's physical evidence in your brain and body to look like the event has already occurred, your brain and body are no longer living in the past, they're living in the future. And you will walk right into your vision, something new you wanted to experience. And the moment you started thinking about this experience, the moment you started contemplating this potential reality, you turned on a part of your brain called the frontal lobe, the crowning achievement of the human being. It's 40% of your entire brain. It is the creative center, and it has connections to all other parts of the brain. And the moment you said, what would it be like to be a leader? What would it be like to be successful? What would it be like to have this vision come true? The moment you asked that open-ended question, you turned on this part of the brain. Because the rest of the brain is just a bunch of automatic programs. And now the frontal lobe, the creative center, wakes up, and it has connections to the entire brain. It's the CEO, it's the boss, it's the symphony leader of the brain. And the moment you get creative, the frontal lobe begins to select different networks of neurons that are stored in your brain from things you've learned or experienced. And as you begin to think a what if question, it begins to select these different networks and begins to seamlessly piece them together and making your brain fire in new sequences and in new patterns and new combinations. And whenever you make your brain work differently, you're changing your mind, because mind is the brain in action. Mind is the brain at work. And the moment those neurons fire in tandem, you get a picture in your mind, a hologram, a vision. For those people who are passionate, that thought that they're thinking begins to create an elevated emotion. They become inspired. They feel enthusiastic. They become passionate. They started to open their hearts. And all of a sudden, they're combining a clear intention with an elevated emotion. And it's the combination of a clear intention and an elevated emotion in our research over and over again that proves then the person now is changing fundamentally, changing biologically, changing internally. And their brain and body are moving from living in the past into living in the future. When you do that, when you had that moment, you came out of your resting state, and then you started to write down all the things you were going to do to get to that vision, all the choices you were going to make, all of the experiences or goals you wanted to achieve, and all of the emotions and the joy you would feel. And when you were doing that, you were setting your sights towards that destiny. And then you did something really brilliant. You wrote down the choices you weren't going to make. You became aware of the behaviors you weren't going to demonstrate. You began to review certain experiences you wanted to stay away from. And then you looked at the emotions that would bring you to a lower level. And you began to separate the old self from the new self. And when you begin to do that, and you're observing the old self, it means you're no longer the program. Now you're the consciousness observing the program. And that's when you begin to objectify your subjective self. And so the moment you stop making the same choices that you always make, get ready, because it's going to be uncomfortable. And that's the moment you are heading towards the new self. If you can linger without a name, without a face, without a gender, without your pain, without your disease, without all the relationships you have, without your past or your predictable future, it makes sense then that the longer you linger in the unknown, where all possibilities exist, by very theory, the more you would create new possibilities in your life. So then, just like in the quantum physics experiments, where they were observing the electron, and the electron went from a cloud of possibilities, the wave function, and it collapsed into a particle. All of a sudden, when they turned their back and no longer looked or observed the electron, it turned into possibility. It's possible then that when you disconnect from everything known in your life, and you're no longer observing your life from the same level of mind, that your life can turn into possibilities, just like the electron turns into possibilities. Now, getting to the present moment is the work. The moment you start noticing that your attention is going to memories of the past that are connected to certain emotions in your meditation, that's the habit of how you've been thinking up until this point. And you have to break that habit, which means that you have to return your attention back into the present moment and unfold as an awareness back into possibility. And every time you do that, that's a victory. When you start to notice that you want to get up and quit, and you settle it back down into the present moment, and you unfold back into possibilities, that means then you're telling your body that it's no longer the mind, and you're executing a will that's greater than the program. And if you keep doing that over and over again, the body will begin to surrender into the present moment, just like training an animal. Once it finally can surrender into the present moment, if where you place your attention is where you place your energy, and all of your attention and energy is in the present moment, you have a lot of energy to do amazing things. So then, all those possibilities that exist in the quantum field exist as electromagnetic possibilities. They exist as frequencies that you have to begin to connect to. So then, what are the ingredients that allow us to tune into those potentials that already exist in the quantum field? Well, it requires two things: a coherent brain, that is a clear intention, and an elevated, heartfelt emotion. That is what begins to open our hearts and creates coherence in our heart. So then, if you are disintegrated in your brain, and that you have incoherence in your brain, and you haven't trained your heart to begin to become more orderly and produce a powerful magnetic signature, then you can't read information or broadcast frequencies into the field. In a sense then, you're on the wrong radio station. And the more coherent your brain is, the more coherent your heart is, the more you can tune into those potentials. Now let's demystify the process. So many people spend their entire life creating in lack. They see something that they want, like a new car or a new wardrobe, and they notice that they don't have it. And when they notice that they don't have it, they experience separation or lack. So what they start to do is they start thinking about having that car, they close their eyes, and in a period of time, they start seeing themselves actually driving the car. But when they open their eyes and they realize that the car hasn't manifested, they start experiencing more lack. So then they try harder to get it. And how do they try? They force, they wish, they control, because they're matter trying to change matter. Once you begin to open your heart, once energy makes it to this center right here, this is our connection to the unified field. This is the center we create from. This is the center of wholeness or oneness. This is where our divinity begins. This is the union of polarity
or the union of opposites. And once energy makes it to this center, all of a sudden, like dropping pebble after pebble after pebble into water, it begins to create a resonant magnetic field. And that field can be up to 3 meters wide. Now you're starting to open up and become more energy and less matter, more wave and less particle. And now once energy makes it here, that energy can carry information or a thought or intention. And you can begin to lay the thought on that energy because that energy is consistent with your healing. That energy is consistent with your new dream. The energy is consistent with your new job or your new relationship. That energy can carry the thought of your dreams. The energy of suffering can't carry the thought of your wealth because it's not consistent with that energy. So then when you begin to open your heart and you raise your energy and you begin to lay the thought on it, think of the thought as the electrical charge in the quantum field. And think of the feeling as the magnetic charge in the quantum field. And how you think and how you feel begins to broadcast new energy and new information into the field. And for whatever you broadcast into the field is your experiment with destiny. So then when you get really good at creating brain coherence and heart coherence, and you know how to elevate your emotional state, and you begin to feel the emotion of your future before it's made manifest, then you're no longer living in lack. You feel like your dream has already happened. So then when there's a vibrational match between your energy and a potential that already exists in the quantum field, now you no longer have to go anywhere to get your dreams. Now you are connected to that field of information that's connected to everything material. And when there's a vibrational match between your energy and that potential, now all of a sudden you'll begin to collapse time and space and you'll begin to draw the experience to you. And now you no longer have to go anywhere to get it. You are the vortex to your creation. So think of it like this. The thought sends the signal out and the feeling draws the event back to you. So if you're intending on having a future and you're waiting for the experience to happen so you can feel the emotions of your wealth or of your freedom, of your new relationship, then you're sending the thought out, but you're not drawing the experience back to you. So here's a great example. The HeartMath Institute did a novel study where they took a group of people that were expert prayers, and they set 3 vials of DNA in front of them. And they said to them, now listen, with all of your intent, we want you to see in your mind the DNA winding or unwinding, and just keep doing, keep visualizing it winding and unwinding. That's the concept of a mind. They did it over and over again, over and over again, and they checked to see if the DNA was changed in any way. And at the end of the experiment, the DNA was never changed. Intention did nothing to affect the DNA. So then they said to them, okay, now open your heart, create heart coherence, and just generate that signal out into the field, and let's see if that energy begins to affect the DNA. At the end of the experiment, they checked the DNA, and there was no change in the DNA. But when they said to those people, now we want you to see the DNA unwinding, and we want you to open your heart and give thanks that it's actually unwound before it occurred. The moment they combined that clear intention with an elevated emotion, more than 20% of the DNA unwound at a remote location. The thought sends the signal out, the feeling draws the event back. Or better yet, as you begin to open your heart and broaden your field, that energy is the handmaiden, or it's the carrier of that thought, and now you can begin to affect the nature of reality. So a fundamental question is, what are you broadcasting on a daily basis? If you finish your meditation and you combine a clear intention with an elevated emotion and your heart is open and you feel connected to the energy of your future, it's your job to maintain that modified state of mind and body your entire day. And if you can, get ready. Something unusual is going to happen in your life. And it's going to come in a way that you least expect, that surprises you and leaves no doubt that it's come from your connection to the field. And you won't be able to predict when it's going to happen or how it's going to happen, because if you're looking to predict it, you're laying down a known over an unknown. You have to live in the realm of possibility, in a new state of being. And the moment you say, I got frustrated because of a coworker, I got angry because I was in traffic, and you disconnected from the energy of your future, now you're back to the energy of your past, and don't expect anything to change in your life. So then our job then is to be able to regulate the state with our eyes open as well as our eyes closed. And the side effect of this, when done properly, are those synchronicities, are those serendipities, are those coincidences that are beginning to come to us, and we no longer have to go and get it now. We are now a vibrational match with everything between now and who we are in our future. And now we are collapsing our future and bringing it towards us. Now that I've shown you how your mind can influence your outer environment, it's my hope that you'll use some of this to begin to collapse space and time into a new reality.